Excuse me. Are you Miss Molyneux? Miss Charlotte Molyneux?
Why, yes.
Oh, Miss Molyneux. What a pleasure. Oh, an honor it is to meet such a poet whose laurels are so richly deserved, and one whose visage is every bit as lovely as her soul. Oh, please excuse my exhilaration. I'm a devout follower of your contributions to the Annals of the Gazette. Your witness in verse, simply lyrical.
You are too kind, Mr.
Trefusis, Aubrey Trefusis.
Oh, Mr. Trefusis, might I say that it is my sincerest pleasure to make your acquaintance, and that I wholeheartedly admire your work, pastels and prose.
You may.
I was especially moved by your latest composition, Whimsy on the Wallaby.
Well, you might say I come from a long line of nature enthusiasts.
Preserving it?
Killing it.
Oh, infinite!
Yes, I fear I'm the only soul in my family who appreciates the fragile beauty of beasts. From my earliest days, the members of my clan have banded together in war against creatures, be they furry, feathery, or scaly. You can readily imagine how intensely such an environment jarred upon my unfolding spirit.
But naturally.
My family is greatly respected in the neighborhood, but I personally have always looked upon them as a gang of blood and brute plug uglies.
Rightly so.
My views on kindness to animals are rigid. My first instinct upon encountering a rabbit is to offer it a lettuce. But to my family, no rabbit is complete without a deposit of small shot in it.
How utterly inhumane!
My father has killed more birds than any other man in the Midlands. And my sister Regina spreads destruction in every branch of the animal kingdom. And my younger brother Wilfred is, as I understand, working his way up to the larger fauna by killing sparrows with an air gun.
Oh, how horrid!
Yes, I know. One may as well live in Chicago as at Bludley Court.
Bludley Court?
The moment I was 21 and came into a modest but sufficient inheritance, I shook the dust of the place from my feet and wended my way to London to lead the life literary. The family, of course, was appalled. My Uncle Francis tried to reason with me for hours. Uncle Francis, you see, used to be a big game hunter. They tell me he's shot more news than any other man that has ever gone to Africa. Oh, that's gun news, of course.
Yes, with a G, silent.
They were when he was through with them. Now I hear he's developed lumbago and is treating it at Bludley with Rigg's superfine emulsion and sunbathing.
But is Bludley your home?
That's right. Bludley Court, Lesser Bludley, Goresby on the Ouse, Bedfordshire, telephone Goresby 28.
But Bludley Court belongs to Sir Alexander Bassinger.
Well, my real name is Bassinger. I adopted the pen name Trefusis to spare the family's feelings. But how do you come to know the place?
Why, I'm going down there next week for a visit. My mother was an old friend of Lady Bassinger's.
Oh, well, what a small world it is after all.
Though from what you tell me, I'm afraid I shan't enjoy my visit. If there's anything I loathe, it's anything connected with sport.
Two minds with but a single thought. Listen here, I'll tell you what. I haven't been near Bludley in years, but if you're going, then dash it, I'll come too.
You will?
I certainly will. I don't find it safe that a girl of your exquisite refinement should be dumped down at an abattoir such as Bludley without a kindred spirit and then more support.
What do you mean?
Well, you see, that house exercises a spell.
A what?
A ghastly spell that saps even the strongest of humanitarian principles. Who knows what effect it might have upon you?
What nonsense.
Well, all I can tell you is that once, when I was a boy, a high official of the Brotherly League of Mercy arrived there, late on a Friday night. At 2:15 that Saturday afternoon, he was the life and soul of informal party, got up for drawing a local badger out of its burrow.
Well, I can assure you the spell will not affect me.
Oh, nor I, but all the same, I'd rather be at your side, if you don't mind, that is.
Mind, Mr. Bassinger, I'd like nothing better. In more bands. Well, we need to wait for the others. Tea, Miss Fuller? Francis is changing after his sunbathing, and the rest are still out hunting.
Well, I suppose they won't be in while there is still something moving out there.
That's enough of that, Aubrey. I had hoped you had come to make your peace with the family. As it is, I don't believe Francis will so much as look at you, but I do expect the others will enjoy a chat.
Very well, Mother. But their chats always end as zoological post-mortems.
Aubrey, my boy. How's the day? Is this holding you late?
Yes, Miss Charlotte Moore. This is my father, Sir Alexander Bassinger.
Smash. Oh. You like it?
And this lady with the collection of cadavers is my sister, Regina.
Lovely, aren't they?
I must confess, Miss Bassinger, I've always preferred animals with a great deal more of their contents inside of them.
This young lad here is my brother Wilfred, although he appears to be out of corpses for the moment.
Hello, Wilfred!
I say, not bad for a younger. Got him right spang betwixt the eyes and split the head wide open.
Did you get this off of the... Okay, what'd you off him with?
A golf ball, about 10 yards.
Alexander, please, the game is dripping on the carpet.
Oh, it's good for, don't you know? Resolved it.
Father, please! You're making Miss Mulliner ill.
Oh, very well. To the cellar, lads. Let's get these things stopped.
Well, I suppose I should go have a chat with the assassins. After all, blood's thicker than water.
Oh!
Sorry.
Now, Miss Mulliner, you must stay until the 20th. That's when we have our annual garden party.
Well...
But you must. It's become something of an event in these parts, and I'm certain Aubrey will remain.
How could I refuse, Lady Bassinger?
Well, there you are, Francis.
Rabbit.
Francis, this is Miss Charlotte Mulliner. Miss Mulliner, this is Colonel Sir Francis Patchley Drake. Would you like some tea, Francis? Then how about some cucumber sandwiches? Miss Mulliner is a friend of Aubrey's.
So, you're a friend of my young nephew. Shouldn't see too much of him, if I were you. Not the sort of fellow I'd like any of my daughters to get friendly with.
You are quite wrong. One only has to gaze into his eyes to see that he is above reproach.
I don't gaze into his eyes. I don't like his eyes. I wouldn't gaze into them if you even paid me. His whole outlook on life is morbid and unwholesome. I'd like a man to be a clean, strong, upstanding Englishman who can look his new in the face and put an ounce of lead in it.
Life is not all new.
You imply that there are also wapiti, moose, zebras, zebus, and mountain goats? Well, you may be right. All the same, I'd give the fellow a wide berth if I were you.
I don't believe I shall, Sir Francis. In fact, he is about to take me for a stroll.
I am?
Yes, you must show me the lake. Such an enchanting haunt.
So what are your thoughts on the family?
How relative everything is in this world. When I first met your father, I thought I had never seen anyone more completely loathsome. And then I was introduced to your sister, Regina, and I realized your father could have been considerably worse. And then Wilfred came along, and I could see Regina's good points. And then Uncle Francis happened, and Wilfred's quiet charm shone through to me like a beacon on a dark night. Tell me, has no one ever thought of doing anything about your Uncle Francis?
Well, it is pretty generally realized that he's now beyond the realm of human science.
I see. Let's discuss more pleasant topics. Oh, Aubrey, how can anyone ever dream of harming the slightest, flimsiest fly? Give me life and joy and beauty.
I'll try. How lovely the world is, Miss Mulliner.
Yes, isn't it?
How softly the breeze caresses yonder water.
Yes, doesn't it?
How fragrant a scent of wildflowers it has.
Yes, hasn't it?
On such a day, the mind seems to turn irresistibly to love.
Love?
Love. Have you ever thought of love, Miss Mulliner? Life is a Sahara through which we all must pass. We start at the Cairo of the cradle, and we traveled to the, well, we travel on.
Yes, don't we?
Afar we can see the distant goal.
Yes, can't we?
And would fain reach it.
Yes, wouldn't we?
But the way is rough and weary. We must battle through the sandstorms of destiny, and face with what courage we may have the howling simoons of fate, and very unpleasant it all is. But sometimes, in the Sahara of life, if we're fortunate, we come upon the oasis of love. That oasis, when I had all but lost hope, I reached at 1:15 on the afternoon of Tuesday, the 22nd of last month. Miss Mulliner, there's something I've been meaning to ask you ever since the day when we two first met. Miss Mulliner, Charlotte, will you be my... Gosh, look at that horky great rat! Come back, Pete! Come on! Get over here! Come back! You must have gone down a hole or something. The fact of the matter is, you should never go out in the country without a good dog. If only I'd had a nice nippy terrier with me, I might have obtained some solid results. As it is, a fine rat gone just like that. Oh well, that's life, I suppose. Now where was I? You must think me awfully rude.
Pray don't mention it.
Oh, but you must dash him off like that.
Not at all.
Well, what I was going to say before I was interrupted was, will you, be my wife?
Oh?
Yes.
Well, I won't.
You won't?
No, never. So this is what you were all the time, Mr. Bassinger, a secret sportsman? And to think I worshipped you, Aubrey Bassinger. I placed you on a pedestal. I believed you to be a great, noble soul, one who lived far above this world's coarseness and grime, on a rarefied plane of your own, thinking beautiful thoughts. But now I see you for what you really are, a thug who goes about the place chasing rats with parasols.
I'm not, I swear, it was that hideous smell that overcame me.
Pa!
What did you say?
I said pa.
Why did you say pa?
Because I do not believe you. Your story is thin and fishy.
But it's true. Could you condemn me for such a moment's passing weakness? Do you think that the real Aubrey Bassinger would raise a hand to touch a rat, save in the way of kindness? I love rats. I tell you, I love them. I used to keep them as a child. Quiet ones with pink eyes.
And as to your theory of the curse of Lundley Court, which turns the greatest humanitarians into bloodthirsty fiends, I regard it as pure banana oil.
But Charlotte!
Good day, Mr. Bassinger. From this instant forth, we meet as strangers.
Going with that gun, Wilfred?
Just shooting.
Shooting, eh? And has no one ever taught you, wretched child, that he prayeth best, who loveth best, all creatures great and small?
No.
Oh.
What's all this about?
Oh, Miss Mulliner, I did not notice that you were there. all this, oh, it's nothing. I just caught this old boy about to go shoot sparrows with his air gun, and I'm taking the thing from him. Tut, Wilfred. Tut! Can you not see that it is wrong to shoot poor sparrows?
But I wasn't going to shoot sparrows. I was going to shoot Uncle Francis with while he was sunbathing.
But it's also wrong to shoot Uncle Francis while he's sunbathing.
Why? Hmm? Why is it wrong to shoot Uncle Francis while he's sunbathing? Think how it would tickle him up.
Maybe you're right. Perhaps it was a mistake.
Yes, and I've had quite enough of mistakes. Read that.
Oh, your latest, Miss Molyneux?
And greatest, Mr. Bastion.
When cares attack and life seems black, how sweet it is to pot a yak.
Or puncture hares and grizzly bears and others I could mention.
But in my animal's who's who, no name stands higher than the new, and each new that comes into view receives my prompt attention.
When Afric's sun is sinking low, and shadows wander to and fro,
and everywhere there's in the air a hush that's deep and solemn,
then is the time, good men and true, with view halloo, pursue the new. The safest place to put your shot is through the spinal column.
To take the creature by surprise, we must adopt some rude disguise. Although deceit is never sweet and falsehoods don't attract us. So as with gun in hand you wait, remember to impersonate a tuft of grass, a mountain pass, a kopje, or a cactus.
A brief suspense, and then at last, the waiting's o'er, the vigil past. Careful aim, a spurt of flame, it's done, you've pulled the trigger. And one more new, so fair and frail, has handed in its dinner pail. The females all are rather small, the males are somewhat bigger.
Now that is unexceptionable. The entire poem breathes that clean, wholesome, healthy spirit of sport that made England what it is today.
It just chafes me, the imbecility of that animal lover's editor. Tone likely to offend? What utter nonsense.
If that animal-loving bird doesn't recognize a red-hot contribution when he sees one, then you can jolly well find someone else who does.
And yet you disarmed that poor lad.
Well.
And his Uncle Francis is precisely the sort of man who ought to have been shot at with air guns incessantly for the past 30 years. The moment I saw him, I said to myself, that man ought to be shot with air guns.
There's much in what you say.
Where is he?
On the roof of the boathouse.
Admirable!
But I was only thinking.
What?
Do you really think, ought we?
Infirm of purpose, give me the air gun.
Well, I suppose you know we have practically nothing on.
You can't intimidate me.
Zambezi, the proper course of action is to start a fire in the brush to flush out the beast. Blast! He's taking cover behind the Bishop of Stortford. Bedfordshire, telephone Gawsby 28.
Am I dreaming? Did I just... Yes, I remember now. I shot Sir Francis with an air gun.
You certainly did. You're not letting that fact disturb you.
Oh, Auburn, how wrong I was to blame you for barring my parents off the chase rat, and how right you were to warn me against the spell of Bludley. Can you ever forgive me?
Oh, Sean.
Aubrey.
Sean.
Aubrey.
Sean.
Hush. What shall we do?
I don't think we had better just go and walk in on the garden party. The atmosphere doesn't seem right. What I would propose is that we take a shortcut through the field to station, catch the 5:50 express at Gorsby to London, have a bit of dinner, and get married.
Yes, take me away from this dreadful house.
To the ends of the earth. Look here, if you look between Lord and Lady Shottingham, you can get the old voice bang against the skyline.
Aubrey, no.
Merely a suggestion.